From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Larry Appelbaum. I'm a music specialist at the Library of Congress. And it's a great pleasure to be sitting on this stage with these two stars of jazz. If you want to get an idea of what's happening today in jazz, you would do well to sit and listen to them in concert and to listen to some of their recent recordings. What we're going to do is talk a little bit about music. We may open it up for some questions, and then we will have the concert at 8 o'clock. For now, I hope you will help me welcome Gretchen Parlato and Gerald Clayton. Welcome back to D.C.
Thank you. I love D.C.
Really? What do you love about it?
I love you guys. I love the people. I love the energy. I love, really, what is not to love about D.C.? It's such a vibrant city, and every time I've played, it's like fire and crowd. It's just a great, great response and a great welcome.
Yeah, it's a soulful city. It's like everybody here's got that vibe, you know, and they bring that to the venues when you're playing for them. Sort of, it's like a conversation with the audience, which I guess it always is, but it's special when the people listening kind of have that rich, soulful culture.
So you're doing a double bill tonight. Some people may be assuming that they're performing together, but they brought their own groups, yes? Who did you bring with you for this event? And tell us some things that we should be listening for in the concert. Gretchen?
Well, I brought a quartet, so including myself, I have Taylor Eichste on piano and Alan Hampton on bass and guitar and voice. And then Kendrick Scott playing drums and singing a little bit too. So you know, I say this all the time, but the band, and sometimes it is Gerald actually, which is not tonight. But musicians that I play with are really like my family. It's like there's a lot of respect, a lot of love. It feels very much like, you know, brother, sisterhood that's up there, and everybody is very supportive and very inspiring. So there's a sense of feeling like very safe and comfortable, but then not knowing what to expect. So we might play the same repertoire, the same even order of the songs, but every time we play them, there's a sense of this risk taking, and you know, anything is possible, and you might hear something and or play something that you've never sung or played before or heard before. So hopefully that's what we will share with you, is just this energy of being very connected and very in the moment and just sharing music.
You've both worked with a lot of musicians over the years. What do you think makes a good leader now that you lead your own bands? Gerald?
I think some of the best leaders know how to lead without actually saying anything, and sort of lead through example, you know, always play at their highest level and at a very inspired level. For me, it's been a process of, it's a trio, so it's piano, bass, and drums, and traditionally the piano sort of takes the leader role. And for me, it's been a process of trying to get out of that mindset and look at it as three leaders, you know, that the bass and the drums are just as equal in sort of dictating where the music can go. And you sort of have to let go, but I think in the end it pays off. You know, there's, like Gretchen said, there's a lot of risk taking and sort of managing these risks. So that's, for me, that's what a leader means now. Besides just playing the melody and sort of saying, okay, we're going to the next section, it's also saying, I'm not in charge here. You know, I'm not always the captain of the ship, and being open to what the music tells you to do.
So it's more collaborative. Yeah, Gretchen said, who's in her group? Who are you working with tonight?
Joe Sanders will be on bass, and I'm stealing Kendrick Scott on drums, so he's got double duty tonight. This whole art form, you know, basically you just seek out like-minded people, and as Gretchen said, I play with her and all the people that she plays with, so it does feel like a family, and it's sort of a mix and match art form, so Kendrick fits right in, And he's done some trio stuff with me before, so it's going to be fun.
When did you two first meet? What were the circumstances?
Well, we're both from L.A. We're both California people.
The Jazz Spot? Was it the Jazz Spot? One of those
Maybe.
Early jam sessions?
A club that does not exist.
Doesn't exist
surprise,
anymore.
Surprise. Sadly. yeah, this could have been 15 years ago or something.
Like probably the year 2000. Maybe 2001, somewhere in there.
Yeah, we actually both went to the same high school, but
really?
Different times. Arts high school, LA County High School for the Arts. But you know, there's just a scene of a jazz scene in LA that's very much like any scene in any city, where it's small. Doesn't even matter if it's a big city or a small city, but the jazz scene is just this group of people that you see all the time. And that you meet and you end up interacting with and hanging out with and playing with. So we just met through the scene of musicians in LA, and then both eventually came to New York too.
I'm going to put you both on the spot and ask you what you like about each other's music. Gerald, why don't you start? What do you like? And I'm not going to ask just about vocals, because Gretchen's not just a singer, she's a musician. So what do you like about her music?
Well, you kind of answered it for me. I think that's really what I love most about Gretchen in comparison to other vocalists that I've worked with, is that she's definitely got more of a musician's ear. It's not so much about her being in front and people accompanying her, but rather she's part of the mix. I think that's really the best quality there is. But I mean, the tunes are all funky, and the changes are, I mean, it's challenging stuff actually. Like, there's not a lot of vocalist gigs that you have to practice for, but Gretchen's is one of them. You get the music, you're like, man, there's a lot of stuff, partially because it's not written out very clearly, Gretchen.
Uh-oh.
No, I'm joking. No, but I mean, there's a lot of details in the music harmonically and rhythmically. It's not the usual singer gig, so it's
give an example of a song that you found you need to rehearse or need to really work on?
Blue and Green, she's got an arrangement of Blue and Green by Robert Glasper that is rhythmically, and oh right, Robert Glasper didn't do any of the arrangement, it was all Gretchen. Collaborative, yeah,
definitely.
So they have this arrangement of Blue and Green where the rhythm is complicated and the harmony is complicated. There's a lot going on, and if you don't spend, you know, depending on who you are, a good 3-4 weeks, you know, checking it out, then you're in trouble.
Well, that's part of the mythology of jazz, is that people can just show up and improvise. And one of the things I want to ask you both about, well, even before I do, Gretchen, tell me about Gerald. What do you like about his playing? About his sensibility?
I think many things come to mind, but there is, you said sensibility, and that is similar to the word I was thinking of as being sensitive, and there's a sensitivity of literally a sensitive touch that Gerald has with what he plays, and everything is really thoughtful and kind of carefully played, you know? And it has this mix of being really of being kind of that triggering your intellect of how you would feel and hear music, and then also there's something that it triggers just emotionally, you know, and kind of in a more emotional, spiritual kind of sense. And to me, that's the greatest kind of art, something that has all those elements. It taps into many different layers that we have as humans, as like listeners and observers to art, you know. And there's just, I love the intimacy of what Gerald, how the actual trio sounds, where everything is very specific, everyone has a role, and it's very precise, you know. But it really, it's you know, going back to the word that you said in the beginning, like just soulful, there's something that that people can connect to, you know, without trying. And his charts are equally bad.
Why?
Just kidding.
In what way?
How so? I'm just kidding. No.
How so?
Coffee
Actually,
stains.
I don't even think I've ever seen his charts. No, I'm totally just messing around. I don't even know. I think that there's a sense of you might have the same sensibility with the band, is that the charts are very, very basic and very kind of skeletal, you
Their
know.
Lead sheets?
Yes. Yeah, okay. Yes. And so I mean, at least for me, my excuse with that is because it's really I'm allowing the band to completely be themselves and to give who they are and what they do to the music. And that really can't be written down, or that's an excuse, or I don't know how to write that down, because it's just this brilliance that happens. And actually every time we play, you know, somebody might change the harmony just a little bit. And so I like to just kind of give basic structure and then allow the people that I ask to play with me just go, you know. And a lot of it is by ear too. A lot of it is like, just listen to, here's the album, here's some tracks from live shows, and just get a vibe and a feel for stuff, you know. Hmm.
There is this mythology about jazz and jazz musicians that they just sort of show up, they improvise, and it swings, right? But as Gerald was alluding to, it involves some preparation. And because jazz does involve being in the moment, I wonder how you both prepare to be in the moment.
For me, the what comes to mind as the most successful ventures therein are when I'm able to clear my mind before we start to play, so that I'm not thinking about, you know, what happened earlier in the day or the travel schedule and all that, and or even, you know, people in your life, just really clear, blank, and then you're truly open to let yourself go where you need to go.
Yeah, but how do you get to that blank
yeah,
state?
Yeah, I mean, it's different for everybody, but meditation and just, you know, really just trying to calm yourself and breathe deep and that sort of thing. But it, you know, it's one of those things that there's not really a formula. It's just something that you, it's trial and error, you know, through experience, I guess it becomes a little easier.
Gretchen, is there an approach you use to get in the moment?
Well, I mean, Gerald's mentioned meditation. For me, it was finding yoga and meditation. So it was first finding yoga, and then meditation is something that comes a little bit later, or is still a little more challenging, perhaps. And the yoga is actually something physical that you can get caught up in. So the meditation part of just sitting still can be a little more, you know, more difficult. But that is the practice. It's a practice. It's the same way that I would practice singing, practice anything with or even exercising. It's just a discipline of being like, okay, this is my time to do this certain thing. So it's getting used to sitting still and used to being quiet and being comfortable with that, and doing something physical that can just literally exhaust your whole body, so that your mind, it's easier to be clear-headed. Like if you're caught up in something and you go out for a walk, even, it doesn't have to be something that strenuous. So maybe the trick too is to actually step away from the music and the task and not get, I actually have enjoy a big balance. You know, I don't spend hours and hours practicing. I'm not that kind of an artist at all. It might be just some minutes or hours a day, if that. Sometimes it's just even thinking about music or listening to it. It's getting in that zone. And then singing actually becomes the meditation for me. It becomes the same kind of feeling as, you know, or meditating or getting on a yoga mat and sit and standing there and just being ready to present something, or ready to fall into a certain kind of cycle or routine. So in all those moments, it's all the same kind of mental state, and I always feel really lucky that you know, we're able to use our art as some kind of healing and like transformative tool, you know, because I always feel it's the same thing. Like if I said, something's on my mind, let me go for a walk and clear my head, I could have something happen, and then it's like, let me just do this gig. And then you perform, and by the end of it, I feel completely transformed. So that's how I feel. Hopefully that's how the other people on stage feel, and that's how listeners might feel too.
You've done so many gigs over the years. Have you ever been in a position where it just wasn't happening on stage? And if so, what do you do to turn that around? Gretchen.
I'll think of general feelings of you don't feel like the mood is right, or there's something going on between the stage and the audience, or maybe the sound is funny or something, or the music, something falls apart. I think my first reaction is definitely to get caught up in it in my head, but then the method to get out of that is to really connect with the musicians on stage. And we're very, thankfully, these are people that I love to be with and that make me laugh, and laughing is the best medicine for anything. So sometimes we just laugh about it, where it's like, okay, this is really not happening right now, and I'll just look over at Taylor and make a goofy face, and then he'll do something funny, and it just connects us in a seemingly silly way, but actually in a pretty deep way, because that's letting go of it, you know. And then all we can do is just try to create and try to listen harder, you know, and maybe end up being quieter and more intimate. So that connects with your whole thing of stillness and getting into that meditative state. It's like, if something's not right, it's usually because something is chaotic and something is off balance. So trying to really come back to like being able to focus and connect with either the musicians on stage and the audience too. Like if someone's talking during a show, which sometimes happens, you know, people have different methods of of dealing with that. But sometimes to me, it's like, I'll just look right at the person and sing right to them. And sometimes, you know, eventually, not in all cases, but they'll actually realize that they're being sung to. And then they'll kind of be like, oh yeah, where am I? And it kind of forces them to be in the moment and for me to be connected. And it's not really, it's saying a lot more and not causing a big scene about it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Gerald, how often does it happen where everything falls into place when it just feels so right for the entire evening?
I don't know. I would say maybe less than 50%, but close to 50%. You know, I mean, there's always going to be something, but that's sort of what we end up kind of enjoying, like Gretchen said, making a joke out of something that sort of puts a different type of reality into the situation, into the music. I don't know. I think a lot of times, like, her answer had a lot to do with being selfless and taking your own ego out of the equation. And when you do that, you are too busy digging what the other person's doing to really know what's going on. And then you get off stage and someone's like, oh my God, that was amazing. What was that? What were you doing? I don't know. I was checking them out. They sounded great. I know he hit the drums in that special way that, you know, made me feel that special way. But yeah, it's kind of hard to describe or exactly pinpoint, you know, what's happening all the time when we do this. But I would say that the perfect scenario of, you know, amazing piano, amazing sound, amazing audience, amazing musicians is probably, you know, less than half the time. But nonetheless, it's really an enjoyable process for us even to juggle some of the elements when it's not always all together.
Before we go too much further, I'd like to congratulate Gerald for his Grammy nomination. Yes? Did you hear that? Yes. Gretchen, you should have gotten one. Yes. But I wonder, how important is recognition to you? How important is it to be acknowledged either by your peers or by the industry or by the audience?
That's a good question. And I think there's the answer that you want people to hear, and then the real.
No, tell
you know
us
what
the
I mean?
Real.
Well,
real.
You want everyone to think, like, it doesn't matter. You know, it doesn't matter at all. But of course you want people to like what you do, and it feels good to get an award, you know? When I won the Thelonious Monk competition, that felt amazing, and it will always feel amazing. And then there's people, you know, that it's not about competition, it's not about an award, or the same thing with the Grammys, where it's like, well, it's this and this and this, and they have their criticisms of it. But I'm sure that Gerald can say it feels pretty awesome to get that recognition. And it's, you know, I think when it's something that's deserved, that's the point, you know. So, you know, I think we all, as artists, we've learned, at least I have, because I was in school forever, then had good teachers, that it's part of the art world to be criticized, you know, and you have to get used to people giving you constructive, hopefully constructive criticism, or get used to the fact that not everyone's going to like what you do. You know, there's people that will like it, but there's always going to be someone that's very vocal about not getting it and not liking it. And, you know, that's just the way that it is. And it's a little bit, I don't know if we've learned that as much being musicians. I know, like, in other art areas, like friends of mine that are visual artists, it's part of the whole process to present a piece and have the whole class critique it and, you know, deconstruct it. And they're being constructive, but it's getting used to that feeling of presenting something and having people tell you what they think of it, even if you don't like what they say, you know.
Well, I'm very curious what you hear when you listen to music. Do you analyze? Do you just feel? What are you listening to for example, when you listen to a pianist?
Yeah, I mean, it's easy to sort of get swept away in the analytical musician mindset, and immediately when you listen to something, say, okay, well, let me figure out what key it's in and what that chord is and all that stuff, and get into sort of the details. But music is still that same gift for all of us, and it has the ability to sort of transcend those literal sort of interpretations of what sound is. It's just sound, and sometimes it can just move you. So, you know, you can sort of try to get outside of that mindset and just sort of listen and see how it affects you. And
give me some examples of things that really move you in sound.
Honesty of expression. You know, when you see, you see Herbie and Wayne, and you may not know what they're doing, you know, because they've been able to build on these harmonic concepts and the music, the repertoire that they're playing. They find a way to discover new things on it every time. So you know, they're out in Pluto in terms of like theory and technically what they're doing is really some, you know, tricky, complicated stuff, but a little kid can understand the emotion behind the way Wayne plays those notes, you know, and that's sort of what I'm talking about. It's
have
just
you
that
ever talked to them about those notes?
Gretchen probably has.
Well, I mean, when I was in the Thelonious Monk Institute, Wayne spent some days talking with us. So, I mean, it's not if you've ever heard him speak or been in his presence, I mean, he says things that you might not comprehend or understand in the moment.
For example,
he speaks in parables.
Yeah.
So he'll say like, "Well, you know, it all starts in the clouds." You know, I don't know. Maybe that's a bad example.
No,
but
that's a great,
you know what
example,
I mean?
That's perfect.
It sort of makes you say, "Well, what does he mean by that?" Well, right. I guess it does.
And all of it makes sense, and all of it is super deep and super simple at the same time, and stuff that could be applied to anything.
I heard Wayne turn the lamest interview question into a golden answer. The guy asked him, "So, we're here at the piano competition, and you know, you play saxophone. So, what is it like being here at a piano competition for a saxophone player?" I'm like, "Are you really asking that to Wayne Shorter?" You couldn't think of anything, but anyways. So Wayne's like, "Well, you know, the instrument isn't really what's important. You know, it's play piano, play saxophone. What it is the mind behind the instrument, and what we need is people to think like astronauts, you know." And it's like, what? How did he get that from? Anyway, that sort of thing.
He's into science fiction, yeah.
Yeah.
And movies. Mm-hmm. You mentioned something about art and artistry. Are musicians, by definition, artists?
Yeah. Yes.
So if you play in a wedding band, that's artistry?
Sure.
If you're playing a commercial on TV in a studio band, that's all artistry.
I think so.
It's one of those those conversations that can get more and more esoteric and existential, because what is art really, you know, and the idea that life is art, and there's, I mean, I think I took a world music class in college, and the first region that we studied was Africa, and he said, you know, the Africans don't actually have a word that is a distinction between life and art. It is, you know, so when you wake up and the sun shines on the field that certain way, you pick up the drum and you play it this way because that's what it means to you. And you say, play that again. Well, I can't because the sun isn't shining on the field the same way. It's just a different experience. So, you know, it's all art. And a musician in a wedding band can express, you know, beauty of life the same way anybody, you know, at Carnegie Hall or something can. Mm-hmm. It's an idea.
It is. I wasn't making a value judgment about wedding bands or or studio musicians. You both have a number of sort of overlapping, some similarities in your background. You mentioned you're not only from L.A. You were involved with Monk Competition. Gretchen won. You were a finalist, yes? And it's interesting to me that you are both the children of fathers who play the bass. I wonder, how does your family background inform your musical choices in your life?
I think for me, it was really, it wasn't just my father. My father is a bassist. But it was also, it was every single person in my family. It was his father, who was a trumpet player and a singer.
He was with Lawrence Welk?
Yeah. 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 And yeah, and a recent discovery was that he was one of the background singers on You Send Me, on Sam Cooke, on that track.
Really?
Yes. He was a tenor. Little tiny guy, like my height, adorable Italian man. But it was, you know, it was everyone on my father's side of the family. I have another uncle, Dennis, who's an actor, and everyone is involved in the arts. On my mom's side, she's a visual artist. She's a web designer. Her father was a recording engineer that built his own studio and recorded Ella and Louie and the Beatles. And her, my grandmother, she had a radio show in the 40s. It was very, very, you know, influential as well. In sharing music, jazz specifically early on, playing Ella and Sarah Vaughan was her favorite, you know, Nancy Wilson, Frank Sinatra. So hearing music, hearing jazz early, it just gave me this foundation, you know, and this knowledge that art is a valid career and profession, and that it's not, you know, I know other people as artists who had families and parents that, you know, would tell them that line of like, you need to get a real job and what about money and all this stuff. And for me, it was always just learning by example that success is not about how much money you make, that it's really following your dream and being passionate and being, you know, whether if maybe it's being an artist or maybe it's not, but it was that realization that kind of what Gerald mentioned of art just being a part of every day, a part of life. So it just gave me this this love for art, whether it was going to be a hobby or whether it thankfully turned into a career. You know, I had that bug. So it's a nature nurture thing. It's then having good education and but it wasn't like my family said you should be a jazz singer and you should play this kind of music and I'm going to help you and this is how it's going to be. It was really like, this is what we do. Find what you want to do, you know? And then I did. And then they've always been supportive and have not just supportive, but, you know, helped me get to where I need to get just by, you know, being there, you know, and well, that's support, I guess, you know, love. Yeah.
Do you believe in fate?
Yeah.
So you think you were fated to become a singer or a musician?
I do, yeah. Especially thinking the feeling of, I think with anybody can relate to that, of having that realization of finding what you love to do and realizing that that you have no other, there's no other way that you could live, you know? It was the feeling of maybe in elementary school or junior high where I was in a production and on a stage, and that feeling like, oh, this is what I need to do with my life. And it's, and then that feeling where it's not even a choice, where it kind of like grabs you here and you're just like, this makes me feel completely alive and I just love this and I want to do this for the rest of my life.
Gerald, did you feel the same way?
I think I do. I think, you know, it's one of those words that's hard for me to completely understand or grasp, but I definitely believe in what Gretchen's talking about, that sort of awareness that we all have internally of like a deep truth of what makes you who you are and what kind of, you know, gets your wheels rolling every day. And we're, you know, we're so blessed to be able to, you know, make careers out of and sort of build our lives around and pay our rent around that innate feeling, that fate, that sort of awareness.
Okay. I want you both to talk just a little bit about some recordings that changed your life. Things that you may have heard over the years.
The first song I ever loved and fell in love with was Don't Worry, Be Happy, Bobby McFerrin.
Why? What did you like about that?
I was just a little kid, and for some reason, I wanted to hear that over and over. It was just so happy. I don't know. I loved it.
I'm sure you're not the only one.
Yeah, everybody loves that song, right? So there was that, and then from then on, it was Oscar Peterson, Night Train. It was a huge record in my life. Oscar Peterson plus one Clark Terry was huge. Every note, still know that. There's a whole string of other records, but those are sort of like before I even thought of myself as like, let me check out music to understand it and to play it. It was just, they moved me. It was that stuff.
Gretchen?
Yeah, Bobby McFerrin was another that was a huge influence. I think when in another time in my life, I backtracked and thought, what was the first ever recording or hearing of his voice, and it was actually the Cosby Show theme song when he sang that. I think that was even before Don't Worry, Be Happy. But then when that came out, I think, yeah, there was something that just hits you and triggers you because it was all his voice. It was all him layering his voice. And then you go and do your homework and get all the other recordings and you know, continue to follow this amazing singer, amazing musician. And something that really shifted my whole life was Jean Gilbert Toulon and Jobim and Stan Getz, and hearing that album. I think it was probably the first track was probably like Girl from Ipanema, and hearing Jean, or maybe Corcovado, it could have been that too, but hearing Jean Gilbert's voice and his guitar and just something that's so intimate and so, I use this phrase a lot, like, so such a quiet intensity and so like simply profound, that was just like, what is this, you know? And this is, and it just hits you and it affected me, and it made me really, I was so aware of how powerful it is to be intimate, and that you can really just think of your art as like an offering instead of like throwing it in someone's face. And you can throw it in their face too, and it's just as effective. But, you know, there was that moved me, and I didn't know what language he was singing. I didn't know anything about what was happening, but it was just the whole mood of Bossa Nova that just really freaked me out. And I was like, I'd imitate it and phonetically like just learn it all by ear, and it sounded crazy. It's like there's recordings from that time that's just, it sounds, it's like, I don't know, I would never want to hear it again, but it was kind of cute that I did that all by ear, and just, I probably, you can't understand a word that I'm saying in Portuguese at all, but just to react like that in such a way, I think is, that means, you know, that means something, and it affected me, and it will always affect me.
So if Joao was here today, yes, with us, what would you want to talk to him about?
Wow, that would be deep. I know I'd probably be one of those like speechless, you know, starstruck people. But I've thought about that because I thought he is somebody that I would love to just ask him about what I mentioned, like that effect, and was that something, just how he came to that, you know? And I'm sure you've been asked that too. We all maybe have been asked that about what we do. Like, how did you come to be where you are now? And I would be curious to know, because he's had such a life and has worked with so many different artists and is so hugely influential, that it would almost just be a very open question of, like, you know, tell me about your path, really.
I'd love to know about his guitar style.
Yeah.
Because he's got that whole bachucada mm-hmm. thing in his right,
right yeah.
hand.
Yeah. How did you come up with this,
he
and how did you
that.
Apply?
Mm-hmm. There was, it
exactly.
didn't exist before.
Yeah.
Amazing. So yeah. we're talking about the things that really moved you when you were coming up. What are you listening to today?
I'm really floored by Gonzalo Rubalcaba's command of the instrument and his creativity and compositionally, and when he solos, his phrasing. I mean, that Gonzalo's really high up there, along with Herbie and Wayne, who we mentioned, and sort of all the greats that we still have to listen to. And then it's sort of different every day. It depends on the mood.
Today, what were you listening to?
Today, I listened to Jeff Keyser, this record. I actually had a bootleg of this trio concert he did. Shh, don't tell anybody. I think he gave it to me. Or no, he gave it to my dad. My dad gave it to me. So it's okay.
That's legit.
It's legitimate. Legitimate bootleg. No. So yeah, I was listening to that. Oh yeah, we were in the car. We were listening to a bunch of stuff. We listened to that Herbie, Wayne, and Bahia Black. I think it's called Aladum, Olodum.
Yeah, that's from a while back.
Yeah, that's some bad stuff.
That's heavy stuff.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you could just put it on shuffle, but there's a really a long list, and it totally depends on what we're in the mood for.
That's interesting. You mentioned the word shuffle. That's part of what's different about music for this generation. So how does that impact the way you perceive music? The fact that, well, I don't even want to put words in your mouth. How does it influence the way you process what you're listening to?
Maybe it's a more honest reaction to what it is that you're checking out. If you press shuffle and then, you know, put the iPod away and you don't see what it is, then you don't have sort of this preconceived notion of, oh, I'm going to put on this record that I really love for these reasons that I've established weeks ago. Instead, it's just, here's some sound. How do you react to it? And you say, oh, I'm really digging that. Or right now, let's go to the next track. So maybe it's a little bit more honest. I mean, the flip side of this generation, sort of the iPod generation, is that it's easy to spread ourselves thin and maybe not get really deep into one recording. I mean, there were the days where people were transcribing records and they had to put the needle right at the right spot.
Did
and
you
that
do
was
that?
I didn't do that.
Yeah, of course not.
I mean, I had tapes and CDs.
You did?
I'm old.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Is that right?
I don't think I
records
of the iPod
did, which
shuffle.
Records did you transcribe?
Charlie Parker, right, I did. And
which one?
Well, this was like, you know, college years of like learning bebop solos, so learning like rhythm changes stuff and learning Donna Lee, for example. And it was either a record or it was a cassette. So
they had
be, like,
record
rewind.
Players yeah. when you were in college.
And see, the whole thing of like I might be on the other end of this shuffle iPod thing of like I actually prefer to hear the whole album.
You do.
And hear how the artist wanted it's like a work of art. It's like a painting. It's like this complete thing. I know that's what it was like for every album that I've done. It's like, no, I want people to have a whole range and spectrum of an experience from the beginning to the end. And it's very, I took so much time thinking of the order of the songs. It's like a set list, you know. You think of, when you listen to our shows tonight, it's like at least I'm sure you have too, unless you just think of it in the moment, which works too. Or I know for me, I'm like, well, let's do this song here and this one here. And you really have a shape, you know. So I do like that. And especially thinking of like, you know, album days, like back in the day, like Stevie Wonder albums where like everything, every song leads into the next one. And it's just this seamless thing. So if you were just to hear the track, you'd be like, no, but this comes from somewhere, you know, it's almost seeing someone's history there. Or it was fun, you know, when I was younger to hear the end of a song and then be able to sing the first note of the next song just because you've heard it together like that so often. And I've thought of that for my own albums too, is like what sonically is going to make sense for people to hear, what key are we in, and what's that next first note, and how is that going to match up. So I'm a little more old school with how I listen to music, and I don't even have an iPod anymore, and it's just kind of,
why not,
you know, because someone stole it.
Okay.
I was at a wedding and I went to valet I don't ever valet anything. I'm really like, I'll just park my car or whatever. And I think it fed. Why am I telling this?
It's supposed to be a celebration
and then
of love.
It fell out of my.
This is all thievery.
The iPod fell out of my purse. I know that that's what happened, and it fell like in the bottom of the passenger side seat, because then when I got back in the car, it was totally gone. But the karma is that I had stolen a lot of music from my friends and gathered a lot of stuff that I had not actually bought. So the karma, I was completely okay with the fact that it was gone. And now I, you know, try to buy and support my friends, you know.
So Gerald told us what he's listening to lately, but yeah. You haven't yet.
Well, I segued into that by saying friends. We have a lot of friends that are incredible, you know, musicians and artists. So, for example, Alan Hampton actually is an incredible singer and songwriter, and I listen to his stuff all the time. Moving Sidewalk is the name of his CD, and even he'll play me, you know, new stuff that he's working on or stuff that hasn't been recorded. But he's a really brilliant singer and songwriter. Becca Stevens is another one, just incredible, gorgeous. Rebecca Martin. And it's great because these are like my favorite people, my best friends in my life too. But stuff that I just bought, I just bought Lettucey's album and Kim Burrell's album, which I believe have been Grammy nominated too. So a lot of, it's funny, some people are always like, oh, surprised that I really resonate and listen to much bigger voices than my own. But I've always have learned and been so influenced by singers that just have this incredibly big, round, resonant tone. And it's really about tone, because it's not about volume, because I try to get that same kind of resonant tone, but my voice can only get so loud, but there's a lot to learn from voices like that, and even, you know, older generations of voices like that, like Stevie and Donny Hathaway and stuff like that. So those are probably staples. Someone like Michael Jackson, Stevie Wonder, those are probably like Bobby McFerrin, kind of the everyday listening. Umu Sangari too. I think I listen to her, that first album of hers, almost every day.
I have one last question I'm going to ask them, but first, before I do, I wonder if anybody out here has a question for Gretchen or Gerald. And if you do, yes.
Thank you.
Okay, let me repeat this just for the cameras. The gentleman in the audience was saying how much he enjoys your covers. He wants to know what draws you to certain repertoire.
I think I like to think of opening up the genre of jazz, even though I think I'm considered a jazz singer. I'm really not very traditional jazz singer at all, but the genre and the repertoire of that music, I think, can be opened up to just material that that has that we've heard in our life and heard growing up. And so the song, you know, you mentioned SWV and the track, you know, Weak, that was something that I heard. I was in high school when that came out, and that was just like, I love this song. And then, you know, later on, I was, you know, met Robert, and we collaborated on other musical stuff, and it was an idea of like, can you help me do something with this song? I would love to sing it. And, you know, I always tell the same story. It's like, he laughed, he was kind of thought I was kidding, but then sat down at the piano and he just made up that vamp and then said, yeah, you probably should just do that vamp and the other sections just keep the same because it doesn't need anything else. And from there, we just turned it into what we do now. So it was that, with that or any kind of pop cover, because I've done a few now, it's really treating them the same way as a standard. You know, I also came up singing, you know, learning jazz standards and singing more traditional stuff, and at the same time I was a, you know, 80s kid, MTV generation, and heard all kinds of pop music. So it's thinking of the material in the same way and thinking of it as just, it's a song, it's a melody, there's chords, there's a structure, and there's a story, there's lyrics. So what can I, you know, how can I sing this? And same thing with a standard that might have been sung a million times, like, you know, if I were to do Misty, I'd be like, okay, everybody has sung this song, but what can I do with this that might be my, that could allow me to tell my own story? So it's the same thing. You want to honor the original version and then maybe, you know, twist it a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Who else? Yes, sir.
It's on the first one.
I
appreciate it.
Yeah, the gentleman's asking Gerald about the emphasis on feeling, especially feeling good, versus trying to impress people technically.
I mean, it's a really important thing for me, and I think it's just a natural extension of what it is that I love about the music that inspired me. And, you know, I grew up listening to really swinging big band music by my dad and, you know, the Ray Browns and Oscar Petersons, and so much of that is more about the spirit and energy that you put behind the feeling of the music. So you're right, that's sort of at the core, at the foundation. And since then, I've just sort of been naturally curious about different ways to do things and sort of other colors and textures and ways to push and pull on a chord or a melody and a rhythm. So it's a matter of manipulating it in a way that, to me, is the right balance and is still tasteful musically and still honest and maintains my integrity or whatever. So, you know, that's sort of what I'm thinking about, is just being honest and making sure that what I'm playing is a really, truly representation of what I'm hearing in the moment. But that's where I'm coming from, for sure. That's home base. It's just making it feel good.
Hmm. We have time for one last one. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
I think I get it.
Yeah, he is asking about, I get, help me, forgive me if I'm paraphrasing too much, but he's asking about the balance of sound and feeling and memory and the language that we draw from, and how do you reconcile all of these things or keep them in balance?
Well, just for, again, my answer is going to be as weird as your question, but, you know, if, as far as memory is concerned, you know, you can memorize how something looks, you know, visually on a page and say, oh yeah, that's that chart that looked like that, and those were those chords. So when I'm going to go play, I'm going to think about, oh yeah, what did that say? That said C minor, and I know C minor is here with these notes, okay. But we don't really want to think that way. It sort of gets in the way of the sound. So if you can develop your ears to a point where you're listening to the language and all the important things that you want to pay tribute to in a way that's just sound, it just is, then you don't really have to think about the technical stuff. You know, that it's a tool. I feel like those things are a tool to put sort of like a educational methodology on art, like make it possible for a teacher to stand in front of 20 people and say, this is how we're all going to hear this, by calling it this. But the fact is, it's the sound is the most important thing. It's just the sound. I don't know if that's really a way of answering it, but even with the language, it's just a matter of listening to it enough and loving it enough that it becomes part of your own expression. It's like a conversation. It's like, you know, any other language. We're not really thinking about the words, although, you know, you have that period where you learn the words, blah, 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 blah. But it is just throwing it around. I don't know. That was a very strange answer, as I warned you it would be.
Well, I'll give you a stranger one.
That.
Yeah. And I don't know if this is really what you meant, but my reaction is it makes me think of lyrics of a song, of being of that kind of fine line of being in the moment of telling a story of the song and being present, like I'm speaking to you right now, you know, and this is just, we're all here in this moment. But then if there is a story and behind a song lyrically, you're going to go back to the memory, you know, you're going to go back to the past and kind of gather what your story is, you know. An exercise I tell singers, I share with singers, it has helped me, is to write lyrics to a song, write it down as if it's a poem, read it out loud and read it as if it's a conversation, read it so that you're able to speak it the same way that you would if it was just us speaking, not like reading a poem. And then try to apply that to singing so that you're singing it the same way that you would speak it. And then write down the story. What is the song? What are these lyrics even about? In a very general sense. And then write down your story. Write down, like, how do you connect to this song? And what is this song about to you? What does it remind you of? What specific event and person interaction happened that you think of? So that when you sing it, this is what I'm relating to what you're talking about. You have that fine line of being of gathering the memory of what you've of your story, but then also sharing that and being very present with everybody else, you know. And that's kind of a bigger picture of just how we are in our lives too, of like that fine line of being present and just reacting to something in the moment, but then also gathering what you've learned. You know, you're realizing we're all just humans, that we have this learned behavior, you know, and learned reaction. And maybe as you're speaking, we're listening to you, but we also in our head we're gathering all of our answers and thinking like, oh well, that's I know what to say. That's going to make me think of something that happened to me in the past. So there's my memory, you know. So it seems like we're always just kind of on the edge and balancing and going back and forth between being in the moment, being in the past, and then even, you know, worrying about like, well, wait, but so tomorrow, where do you go tomorrow? And then what time is your flight? And how am I going to get home? And then what's happening tomorrow? And oh, we go to Paris in a week. Okay, well, what do I need? You know, all those things. So you can think of how you are in your own life and then apply that to your art, which kind of wraps up the whole theme. you know?
It does.
It's all the same thing.
In fact, there's no need for this final question.
So
I think we've done it.
Thanks for coming. Yeah.
Yeah, no, really. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for your question. And thank you to Gretchen and Gerald.
Thank you.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.